About the urban geology challenges, which is also one of the themes of this conference, and the smart cities. Now, as per the government dispensation, nearly 100 smart cities are coming up. And if we go by the world standards, nearly 2,500 smart cities are coming up in the world, particularly the BRIC nations. People, we definitely aspire for better standard of living, better facilities at our command, and much more optimal utilization of the available resources. So my emphasis here, I'll be giving some examples about Jaipur and Ajmer, which are just on the margin of the Thar Desert, particularly in the dryland environment. Again, water is the most important issue here, as has been mentioned by the predecessors also. So next, please. So the pink city, Jaipur and Ajmer. Jaipur, as we all know, is nearly 300 old years city. It is one of the finest examples of the planned city of the time, nearly 1727 when it was established. And the facilities which were provided within the walled city had taken adequate care of the climate which was prevailing. And the covered veranda concept, which was later on practiced by the Britishers while they built Connaught Place. The covered veranda concept is of Indian origin, because our climate has dictated that we need to have covered verandas, particularly during hot summers, for the customers to move around in the markets and all that. And Ajmer, of course, as we all know, is a city of hopes. Next, it's a, these are the, Jaipur has become urban region because more than 3 million population, 31 lakhs is the population now. And Ajmer is the metropolitan, nearly 5 lakhs plus population now. And they have been listed to become smart cities. And also they are very rich in heritage and cultural and religious tourist destinations, particularly in the dryland West India. And there is definitely a greater need, because each city will have its own characteristic growth standards. So there is a definite greater focus is to be put on the tourism related amenities for a city to become real smart. In fact, I have been agreeing with the tenet that cities are smart if the people there are really smart. So it is basically, you know, making people smart first. Only then the facilities which are provided, they can be utilized to that optimal extent. Next, please.
See the location, it is right at the desert margin, almost the semi-arid part, the Aravallis, the main mountain hill valleys which separate
the Thar Desert on the west and more wetter areas on the east. And the rainfall is very important, and typical characteristic features of a desert environment or dryland environment is occurrence of flash floods. We may not have the recurrence periods of the recorded meteorological data, but whenever it rains very heavily, since the drainage is non-existent during normal times, it will definitely flood the surfaces which are there. In fact, the roads. When I joined the Geological Survey of India on transfer from Shillong to Jaipur, I was warned that when it's raining, don't just wait, don't get a shelter, just move, go to your destination. Because after rains, the roads become nalas, the roads become the carrier of the excess water. So that is the situation in most of these semi-arid climate cities the world over. Recently there was a flood in Dubai. It is not unusual for any desert-like situation to face this kind of flash flooding. And of course, we have very high evapotranspiration and very erratic rainfall, and salinity is generally higher in the groundwater regime also. So both the surface water scarcity is there, and the groundwater is also not of a very good quality. So these are the inherent geological constraints, the geological challenges that the cities, if they are growing in particular desert margin environment, they have to face. Next, please. Okay, now you can just see the Ajmer city, right, nestled within the Aravallis. And the Jaipur city is also bordered on the northern side with the Aravalli hill ranges, mostly resistant quartzites Of course, they are very important so far as construction material are concerned. So they are very readily available. But then because there has been over-exploitation, hills have been degraded, there has been banned by the Supreme Court for mining of all this construction material, including the hard rock as well as the sand from the rivers, which are very, very, very essential for the construction of any developmental aspect. So I'll be just highlighting these white stretches that you see here. These are the major lineaments which are traversing this area, and I'll show you the work which we had done. In fact, I had taken up a project when I had become director of doing master plan for Jaipur Development Authority way back in 2007 and 8, and I'm really glad to share that most of our recommendations, they were accepted by the commissioner of JDA, and they were incorporated in the master plan 2050. And the recommendations which we made at that time are still valid. I mean, thanks to the slow administrative controls and the political will, which is actually, I would not say implementing, they are not implementing many of the things. The things go very slow. And despite all those recommendations, the present scenario has not changed much on the ground. Similar is the situation for the Ajmer region. So I'll be just highlighting few of the things which we had recommended based on the geofactors and the geological challenges which these two regions they face. Now, material, of course, these are the standard things, the lithospheres which are interacting, and particularly the hydrosphere is the most important aspect which is affecting the biosphere and hydrological cycles. Most of the cycles, this tectonic cycle and the hydrological cycle, they are the important controlling geofactors which have greater role to be understood and to be implemented properly with our geological knowledge and with the engineering solutions that we have to face these challenges. And climatic domain, four major challenges I would like to enlist. In fact, they are the major pillars even for the resourcing for future generations also. Like, we need to evaluate comprehensively the supply and demand for the resources. How much water is available from various sources and how much is the demand in terms of time slices and in terms of population slices. How many people are going to inhabit a particular area, because these cities are major attractions wherein the hinterlands, wherein the people from the adjoining rural areas, they will migrate. So migrants are definitely a floating population, but they are also human beings. They also need the basic amenities. And this prognostication has to be done in a very rigorous manner and must be renewed, must be rigorously monitored and updated as the time passes. Second important aspect is the subsurface. Again, here it is very important that we know more and more about the subsurface aspects, not merely through the conventional methods of drilling, but through geophysical methods. Nowadays, we have the GPR surveys and all that. We really need to know a lot more details about the subsurface, at least the top 30 meters or so, which is really actually helping in growing a city, sewerage lines, groundwater conditions, soil conditions, the foundation conditions. These things are really very, very relevant now, and Geological Survey of India must rise to the occasion and take up these details wherever they have not been done in right earnestness. And the third aspect is, where else can we find the resources if there is a gap in the resources that we really need to support growth of a smart city? Where else can we find those resources? Whether water resources as per the rainfall and the groundwater situation, are they sufficient? Whether recycling is being done properly so that we meet the demands, or are there adjoining area regions wherein higher rainfalls are there and we need to divert water or import water from different basins? This total assessment has to be done in a more realistic way for optimum utilization of the available resource. And the fourth point is, do we have the needed skill levels for managing our smart cities? Because we'll be incorporating more and more on information and communication technology, ICT, for the smart solutions. Do we have the required skilled manpower to be manning those devices and institutions wherein the services are delivered? This is very important because this has to go hand in hand. It is just, we cannot just transform the society overnight. We have to really prepare our society from a traditional base to a much more modern computer savvy base. Tectonic aspects, these regions are safe. Seismic zones 2, it is safe so far as the tectonic aspects are concerned. But then we are now utilizing the positive aspects of this tectonics and the lineaments and the master geofractures, which are definitely going to be helpful for infiltration of the surface water into the groundwater, for recharge aspects and all that. And this is what was our emphasis, because the water conservation has to be very important, these aspects. Of course, geofactors are the standard ones. This is what most of the geological investigations in Geological Survey of India, we have been adopting these abiotic factors, the geology details, the geotechnical properties, the geomorphology, which is very important for any parcel of land use, and the water resources, both surface as well as the ground, and then of course the soils and meteorology. And on top of it, the operative natural processes. Now, since these two cities are on the margin of the desert and on the downwind side, we need to really take care of the wind energy and the erosive power of the winds there. Because a lot of sand erosion, lot of dust storms are happening in these particular areas, which are a great hindrance for development of certain modern features which are normally available in other areas wherein the rainfall is better, wherein the winds are not so strong. Again, the Jaipur city, as we view it from the satellite, and this has been really a great help, because we can have a real good bird's eye view of the totality of the region, and we can really plan for a regional development wherein smart city development is only just small part of that total regional development. I'll just emphasize on how this is really linked. Again, the Ajmer city, we see the Aravali hills, and the water bodies which were there during the earlier days, most of them are unfortunately filled up and reclaimed for constructing buildings and all that. In fact, they are the real lifelines for the people who are living there, and the cities are made smart, because if we make our resources much more amenable to use by the local people, then we are meeting our resource demands. So urban pressures, rapid urban industrial growth, rising migrant population, this is important aspect which gets generally ignored, and unfortunately these aspects, they become the political vote banks, but at the cost of the people and their living conditions for the smart cities. Then conversion of agricultural land for non-agricultural use. This is happening in much more increasing way nowadays, because where else will the city grow? Instead of having a vertical growth, which naturally is more energy intensive, we need a regular supply of energy to maintain vertical growth. We tend to spread horizontally first. And that eats into the areas which are better suitable for agricultural practices inherently because of the geological factors. And then, of course, the traffic congestions and transport issues, they are all there for the overall planning. And it, whenever there is a migrant population, it leads to unplanned growth and large-scale mismatch of land use and land capabilities. Impacts, we have already known about it. Where are the aspects of our solid waste disposal? Again, here geology can play a very major role in selecting the sites where the waste can be disposed of. Those areas have to be inert, wherein the percolation of the water should not contaminate the groundwater, which is already in a very bad condition or which is already overexploited. And similarly, there are air and noise pollutions which are attached to it. So those aspects, I will not go into more details, but those aspects related to solid waste disposal and protection of the hills and water bodies, these are very important and they need to be given good priority. response, of course, there are very good sounding acronyms for this. Jawaharlal Nehru Nation Urban Renewal Missions, and then AMRUT. Nowadays we have these schemes and good funds are being plowed into these for rejuvenation of the urban area, and Swachh Bharat Mission, of course. And these are the issues which are again dependent on high energy inputs, and then new and renewable energy and recycling, and then quality monitoring. These are also emerging aspects wherein geology has been playing very, very important role. And then, of course, particularly for Jaipur and Ajmer, the heritage development, the Retd, these are the latest inputs from the Planning Commission, the Retd, which are related to conservation of heritage, and I would also add conservation of geoheritage also related to these aspects. 5 more minutes? Okay, sir. So, these are the issues wherein I would emphasize that development or the growth of a city, smart city, it affects its hinterland. Smart city should not be treated in isolation. Therefore, a totality has to be considered, entire region needs to be considered for its resource and hazards evaluation, and a holistic or a comprehensive geo-environmental assessment is the primary consideration, inclusive of growth. And then decongestion. We had already recommended and accepted by Jaipur Development Authority that please decongest and develop satellite towns. Fortunately, they are doing it, and I'll just quickly round down on some of those slides. Hydrological issues are very important. Water resources, we have to really plan for their conservation. And land use and land resources are also becoming other determinants for the growth of a particular city. And energy, minerals, rocks or metals, which are really needed for actual construction and providing the basic needs of a growing smart city, they are very important. And what is the actual final output, final the waste that is being created by use of these things, because every structure has got its own life. So we need retrofitting, we need redevelopment of many of the areas. Where are we disposing them? Are we recycling it? These are the aspects wherein the municipalities have to pay greater attention. And I'll just quickly run down how the water budgeting was done initially and how they have been failing consistently, because the prognostication was not done the way it should have been done with the proper projections and modeling. Water resources, the drainage system needs to be understood as part of the geomorphology. And I'll just mention one of the drainage systems within Jaipur city. It used to be called Amanisha Nala. It used to be a dirty drain carrying the filthy water. But thanks to the rejuvenation aspect and growth of that smart city, this is the earlier photo in 2008, lot of encroachment. Water was naturally non-existent many of the months during a year. It used to flow only during the monsoon and all that. But now you see how it has been reclaimed and the river is revived. It is now called Dravevati Nadi. This is the latest scene, which was recently inaugurated just prior to the announcement of elections. And nearly 50 meters span, this river has become a lifeline now. A lot of water is treated. There is sewage treatment plants established here, although these are very, very cost effective. And we see a good flowing water after the treatment of the sewage which was earlier being dumped. It is being dumped even now, but now it is getting treated. Those red cross lines you see are the lineament features which are really suitable for recharge of the groundwater. So that area we had recommended that please keep this for agricultural practices or develop recreational zones so that the area is kept away from the concrete covering or the roads and blocking the infiltration passages there. They were agreed, but how much of it is actually implemented on ground, that needs to be seen. Similarly, various ways for rainwater harvesting and developing recharge structures. So rainwater harvesting, it must be made mandatory for most of the urban areas for actual recycling of the water that we really need. Look at the heritage aspect on the left. This is the Ajmer Fort and the modern, the World Trade Parks and such modern malls which have come up in the city. And all these are coming up with the growth of the population, and of course the basic need is the water, and that is also planned to be met. Again, they agreed for the satellite township. A tunnel was built across the Aravali Hills. There is another satellite town coming up. It is called Kanota. So through this tunnel, the passage, the connectivity was improved. Metro rail is there and rapid transit systems. Many of the unplanned growth aspects are blocking the passages of the water, and this is what we see. You see the active sands on the back of these.
Sir, time to conclude, please.
Okay, I'll just run through. Just one of these slides, I'll just show you. See how the drainage is also getting obliterated. These are the slum areas which have just come up, and it is blocking the natural drainage. And during a flash flooding, there's going to be a huge disaster on these areas. Similarly, very poorly consolidated grade. These are the Aeolian sands, and you see the multi-storied buildings which have come up. Look at these lined gullies. They are the drainage lines, but they are not effective. In fact, during a very high rainfall, there is going to be a failure of these. I'll just quickly run down and come to the conclusions part. Ajmer city, again, we had shown these lineaments, these major fractures, which are really good recharge areas for the groundwater. And because they are overlain by the quaternary formations, they are very good groundwater aquifers, and they are being tapped now, particularly the area between these two red lines. Drainage system needs to be agreed, and of course the waste disposal, initial concept was dilute and disperse, concentrate and contain was the subsequent one, but now we really need to emphasize on this this segregate. Dhawan sir, I'll just take a couple of minutes only. Segregate and recycle. This has become very important because nowadays we are generating a lot of e-waste, and as the city becomes smart, there will be more and more of e-waste generation, which is a real challenge, because a lot of metals can be extracted, very rare metals can be extracted from this e-waste, and there is need for having a good industry for extracting these rare metals from the electronic waste that we are going to dump. Solar power panels, they are coming up in a big way, particularly in the dry land environment. This is a huge potential, and as mentioned by Mishra Saab also, this is renewable energy and very cheap, comparatively cheap. Now we have better devices for their storage.
Sir, conclusion slide going to,
yeah, that's right, we are just on the conclusion part. So smart cities cannot be treated in isolation, holistic approach is needed. Satellite towns is the answer. Decongest, decentralize the issues. Then water resources, of course, rainwater harvesting and linking of the rivers. This is now gaining much more importance. We have to link various flowing rivers and conserve the water. And then waste to energy resource. This is very important because herein lies the actual recycling and resource recovery. And then encourage conservation substitution, and attach, of course, greater importance for geofactor considerations, urban geology. This could be one of the recommendations towards the end of our this conference, that geological consultations are a must for any urban development. Although we in GSI have been doing it, but many of our reports are not really transmitted to the concerned authorities with that force and conviction which they should adopt. So thank you very much.